what some people have called the golden age of Grange HIll, and between them, they created some of the most iconic characters of the series and were involved in some of its most iconic storylines. We've got most of them here. So, first, welcome on stage, Mr. Erkan Mustafa. And let's have Melissa Wilkes, Jackie Ryan. And as the bad boy of Brookdale, Mr. Tim Polly. And is Lee in the toilet slumped on the floor? Okay, good. Hello.
Hello.
Welcome. We'll keep our eyes peeled for Lee. But how is it to be nearly 30 years later talking about Grange HIll?
Well, to be honest, I get asked quite a lot about it, so it's just...
That's another day.
That's just another day, really, to be honest. But it's great to see so many people come down today and who've made a big effort to come from Oxford and Leicester and places like that, Nottingham. And it's good that the fans of the show have got an opportunity to ask questions, and that's what we'd like you to do today, is really ask questions about the show. So that's what I'd like. So it's good to be here.
Right. Yeah. Is it surprising, listen, it's still... this time later people have got such affection for it.
Oh, absolutely, right. Absolutely. It's like you grow up with fans, don't you? It's,
oh!
Zammo!
Hey, yeah.
I still call him Zammo.
Just say no.
Yeah.
We had to get it in.
What was the question?
Is it surprising that it's still people have grown up with it?
And yeah, we've grown up with our fans, really. I mean, we're all kind of the same age. You know, I was 14 when I started in Grange HIll, and I was 18 when I left. So I kind of grew up. I went from, you know, being a girl to sort of being a lady. And yeah, and it was, you know, still kind of putting on a uniform at 18, thinking you're all, you know, very grown up. You'd drive to the studio and stuff like that. And no, it's really, really nice to see, because I was a fan of Grange HIll before I got to be in it. And I was kind of, I'd really look up to like Tucker and, you know, and Claire. And Terry, and I was quite disappointed when I got a part in it, because I thought, oh, it's going to kind of ruin it for me, but it is, it's part of my childhood, and obviously, well, people sitting here, it's part of yours as well, and thanks for coming today.
Well, we're going to give each of you a little trip down memory lane. We're going to start off with you, Erkan, with some of your moments.
Your best bits.
From the series, your best bits. This is what you could have won.
Thank you.
3 years crying and eating KP crisps. Amazing.
But it's amazing though, isn't it? Because Roland was very much almost a figure of fun at the start, wasn't he? And it became such an affectionate kind of, the response you must have got from people.
The whole idea of the character of of Roland in Grange HIll was to show bullying for starters, mm-hmm. and how he reacted and how school dealt with the bullying situation. So for me as an actor, playing it was easy, you know. He was just look down and just cry, you know. That's what I had to do for 3 years. So yeah, he did sort of, for the first 3 years, the public loved him because of his, you know, he was getting bullied and they wanted to protect him and support him, and people would say, you know, we feel sorry for you, Roland. And then basically he came of age, and you know, he started to get a bit bigger than his boots really at times. Yeah.
Did you like Roland?
He wouldn't be my friend, to be honest. he wouldn't be my friend, because. But no, he's a great character to play, because you know. You see him grow, you see him develop, and you know, you saw love interest, which, you know, who'd have thought about it? And I'm still friends with Jessica, who played Fabienne. She was over 2 years ago, so we went out for dinner, which was quite nice. And I see Simone Nylander, who played Janet. And a funny story: we went out for lunch, and. After we were just walking around Covent Garden, and some guy came up to me and went, "It's Roland, isn't it?" Went, "Yeah, it's nice to meet you, whatever." He says, "It's Janet." He said, "I'd always knew you two would get together." So yeah, he came a long way. That was really good to see on screen.
And for you, because you didn't go to a drama school, did you?
The way that the BBC found me was there was no fat children in stage schools. So there was an advert saying in the national press, fat child needed for BBC drama, and a teacher said to me, "Why don't you go for it?" You know, I was a child and I was fat, so yeah, I fitted the part. And I went up for the role, and when I was auditioning, my brother's best mate was at the audition as well for another part, so it was quite easy for me to read the script with him. So there was 2,000 people, and I had two auditions, and I got the part. So I never had I never went to drama school like the rest of the guys. All sort of knew each other from their own drama schools. So I felt a bit strange in the first year, because I felt like I didn't belong.
Right.
Because one, I never done any acting and whatsoever, but two, because I'd never been to a stage school. So yeah.
But it sounds like it was a really close cast, and it must have felt quite welcoming.
I mean, you put 30 kids together in a room or on a coach every morning. We're going to get close, you know. It's those journeys, yeah. 7 o'clock in the morning. You remember meeting you at Mile End in the morning, and it's like our sleep still in our eyes, you know. we became very sort of close, and because we're working with each other every day, 9 months of the year that we was sort of, it just seemed like we were just on Grange HIll for like every day for 6 years. It seems like I never did anything else apart from, you know, Grange HIll. So yeah, we all were very close back then, but obviously as time goes on, you know, how many people do you still remember from your school days? How many people do you still see from the first job? Mm. You know, people say, "Oh, you must be best of mates." Well, not really, because we only see each other. Lee and I work together, you know, we do a lot of stuff together. Melissa we see now and again. Tim, when he comes over, we see. Terry I see quite a lot because he lives quite local. So it's a bit strange that you were such a close-knit family and then suddenly you just go, see you later.
I suppose for all of you, it must feel like you're part of some kind of club, I guess. You're all in Grange HIll. You know, yeah. That must be kind of special, I suppose.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes. It is exclusive, you know, especially the class of what we call the class of 86, 87, because it came about that, you know, we had some great storylines, we had great writers, great directors, and you think that at the time, that people, you know, if we tell people these days, that we only had three channels to 1984.
Yeah.
1984, we had four. So when we all came home from school, we just switched the TV on and just watched Grange HIll. So 15 million people watched that programme. Now, got to have a royal wedding or a big football match to get 15 million viewers. So yeah, so it is an exclusive sort of club, as you know, in one way.
Well, Lee, we're going to give you some Grange HIll memories now. So I'd like to turn your eyes to the big screen. When you first heard about the storyline with the heroine, did you remember what?
I mean, to be honest, we did one of the best characters was written out of Grange HIll was Jonah. I'm not sure if people remember him. There was me and Jonah, a character played by Lee Spark, and we had a really good little bond, and it was a really good partnership. So he was written out, he was supposed to die, but he didn't. Jeremy died, and then when he left, I was a bit lost. I was like, you know, he was my, you know, Laurel and Hardy, he was my right hand man. And so I think I did a bit. Then they asked me to do the drug story, which by Anthony Minghella, who was the story writer at the time, and they had a chat with my parents. And at that time, heroin in the early 80s was, not heard of, especially amongst kids and teenagers. So for me, it was just a storyline that came along, and it was going to be intriguing to do it. I knew it was quite intense because obviously the chats with my parents with the producers and stuff. But when I did it and took it on, it was a massive thing because normally as Grange HIll, you learn your lines, you go in, you do it. It's like going to school, you say your bit. But with that, there was a bit of research involved, and I had to go to rehabilitation centres and meet up with other addicts, and it was quite an eye-opener for me, but it was a really good storyline to do. And then I still don't think I realised the size of it until afterwards, and I look back now with the Just Say No campaign, the record, all right, not brilliant, but the record they're going to, I mean, as a 16-year-old, to go to the White House to see Nancy Reagan, you know, the First Lady, and we sang at the Yankee Stadium, and, you know, all of us went round, and it was just, like, unbelievable at that time. Now, at 16, I think we all took it as a bit of a joke thing, but it was like, because I remember them coming into the green room saying, right, okay, you're going to go into America. And we was like, yeah, cool, that's going to be it. Like, we was gutted if we weren't going. We was all trying to make sure we went. But now I look back at it and see the reaction of people and the impact it had at that time. Mm. I suppose now I realise that I probably took it a bit for granted at that time.
Probably the best way to do it, because, I mean,
if I'd have, everywhere, weren't you?
It's your face, like, you're on Wogan, I think, at one point.
And yeah, just, we like, did. You know. It was on before Bros, and Bros coming on a helicopter, and I was, like, on there. I was like, what am I doing? But again, at that time, if I'd known now, I'd been absolutely terrified. But I got a call saying, you're on Wogan this evening. I was like, yeah, that's cool. I'm doing Bros. But now I look back, and it's just, like, memories that, you know, I'm then... Hopefully, when my little boy is a bit older, I'll show him, and they'll have the impact on him. Because Facebook's a real eye-opener to what reaction people get now. And the thoughts that, you know, the memories people have got of Grange HIll. Because I remember rushing home from school before I was in Grange HIll, and Tucker was in it, and I couldn't wait to get home. And it was all that was on, and Grange HIll was like a massive thing then. And then to be in it was like really, really... And I'm sure for the rest of the lads, you would... go into Grange HIll half day and then go back to your normal school. So it was really weird for us at that time. But then leaving, I remember leaving and I was distraught. I was thinking, I'm going now, because you know you've only got a short period of time in it. When I was leaving, I was really gutted and whatever. But now you've got Facebook and I get inboxes from people who said we grew up with that. And you realise what an impact it had on people of our age. There was a thing on Facebook the other day and it said, what age did you watch Grange HIll? And you realise it's like all the 40s or late 30s and 40s. And I get people coming in my shop. I run a locksmith shop and I get like grannies coming now and I realise I'm getting old because they bring their grandkids. Oh, we used to watch it. But I'm like, how old are you? but it will, you know, it's been part of my life and it will be part of my life till day I die. I love it. I've just started watching my little boy's 5. And he's watched a couple of the Grange HIll episodes, and he's obsessed with Erkan and Roland, I love you. He says, why does that little girl keep saying Roland looking after him? And say, it's really sweet. So it's got an impact on him now, you know, 30 years on. So it was brilliant. I loved it, and it's lovely being in touch with everybody now.
I mean, at the time, did you love it? You know, that level of, because it must have just propelled
you. Oh, of course, yeah.
Like
to be in it was like unbelievable to be auditioned for Grange HIll because it already then, it started in 76 and I was in it in 81. So to be in a program so iconic at that time was, you know, it was like a dream come true. And then our first ever episode was the Cheshire and Zoo episode. It was episode 12, but it was the first one we filmed. And it was unbelievable. And it was just like a roller coaster. I think they brought us in
to say, look, here's some fun. Go and have some fun filming this episode. And then the real work started after
that. But it was unbelievable. And then to get a girlfriend in it, like Melissa, it was like, wow, this is like, you know. And I fancied Melissa from a baby when I was younger. We was at the same drama school. So for me, it was like, oh, this is perfect. can't do any better. And then, and now it's still with me and with lots of people as well. I love it.
Great. Well, Melissa, speaking of you, it's time for your trip down memory lane. As Queen of Grange HIll style, Jackie Wright, let's have a look at some of your memories.
Yep.
Yeah, Max, when he comes in.
Come on.
You like him?
I don't like him. I mean, I don't really like anyone. And I'm sticking up for you.
old man in the school. I should be doing my exams by now.
You've gone to someone else then.
Oh, God, it must be for really long in fact, does. And it's the guy next to him, but he's forgotten.
No. Who is he? I don't want to put anything in Charlie's pockets.
Who are you in Charlie's pockets? Got a cigarette in my class in the past fortnight.
Don't stop, please.
Hey, Russell, get off me. What's that got to do with it?
When you see yourself back there, Melissa?
I just think I look so young. And I spoke like that. I look like my daughter. I've got a 24-year-old daughter, and she's got them kind of them cheeks that I had, and she's got them. And I've forgotten a lot of the episodes and a lot of the fashion as well, and some of the storyline. But, I haven't watched any Grange HIll for years. And, but it's just brought back so many memories.
Good memories.
Yeah, really good memories. Yeah, really, really. And we were so close. We all were close. And, for the record, we didn't. because we were friends. we were really close friends. I'm looking at we were really, really close, and we did. We knew each other since we were like 8 years old. So,
but I always fancied it, for the record.
We did grow up together. No, we were more like brother and sister, and the cast were really, really close, and it was really good fun. Going to work, it was like going to work but getting paid, and it was lovely.
It must have made that closeness, must have made those really dramatic scenes you had together much easier to, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, for any kind of actor or actress, that kind of part is a gift, but for a young actress especially, you know, what was that like?
Sometimes we'd have a sort of joke with it, but the drug story, and especially that one with the lockers, I remember really clearly filming it that day, and it was really intense, and you know, where we're fighting with the lockers, and it was really intense, and it was really serious, and it really felt like you were doing proper acting. And I remember that, and they'd never the crew would never do this, but they let us take home a video tape of the rushes, like of the whole day's filming. And I remember kind of watching it on this video recorder, it was about that big, and just watching it and just feeling really emotional, because I think that it was coming to an end. I think the series was kind of coming to an end, and it was, you'd feel, because I mean, like you guys, you have a lot of love for Zammo, and to see him going through that was kind of, you know, like you could sort of cross over with real life, was kind of painful, really, to see someone who's so, you know, a boy that kind of, that, you know, that was affected by drugs and addiction, and he's someone's son. He was her son. And I got really, really choked when I saw your mum, kind of, because it was. And then and we were filming that scene, and the police walked in, and it was just, I think we did it in one take as well, so it was really real, and it was really kind of really emotional.
Affecting.
Yeah.
Well, Tim, it's your turn now for your trip down memory lane. Let's have a look at Banksie in action.
The original Banksie.
Name.
Name. One name. Do you want to do this, Thanks.
well, the concierge. That's what I need. A good woman's kids in the school. I'm arguing you, mate.
Good brother.
Yeah, maybe we should be arguing, aren't we then?
Do you know what? That's the first thing for me, I'm going to go to the
school.
It's
painful. I wouldn't mind you, it's for me.
Oh, what kind of squashing? Go down, settle down.
You mean you two settle down? You're matching together. How romantic.
Dance? Come on, dancing.
Why not?
Come on, we're supposed to be games, knives, water things.
And dancing.
What's it about being that tone soft?
Action. Me and my brother like that. What's his? It's mine.
You're entertaining little book. Every time I talk to you, you start doing that, I. Listen, have to cure yourself before you start listening.
Nah, you're fine,
Tim, were you happy with the way Banksie's character developed, or would you have liked to have seen him be more of a... Because he started off quite bad, didn't he?
I think I was happy with the way he developed. I like being the naughty boy, I must admit. But it was also nice to become like the nice guy, because they put Lee, obviously, the Zammo character on the drugs, they turned my character around and started making me a bit more of a nicer fella. So yeah, I was happy with it, yeah. And it was good fun. They let me fall off the bike, for instance. They let me ride the bike, things like that, for instance. It was all good fun. They actually let me do that, which I didn't think they would, but they did. I nearly killed myself on the dance floor. But yeah, it was, like everyone else has said, it was brilliant fun filming it back then. Thoroughly enjoyed myself, yeah.
For you, the whole Just Say No campaign is a bit kind of bittersweet, isn't it? Because you didn't get to go to America.
No, I didn't. Me and Lisa York both got dropped last minute, which we were both extremely gutted about. But such is life, you know. We didn't go. That was one of those things. But it was a great campaign they all went on. And yeah, it was bitter at the time, but it was all passed.
And did you like Banksie?
No. My mum likes to say I didn't act, I was exactly like him, which is just not true. My sister's standing over there and she's nodding her head that I was like him, but I was nothing like him. Moody maybe, yeah, but I wasn't a hard guy, put it that way.
Now, we've seen a couple of times on there Michael Sheard. He's a bit of a Grange HIll legend. What are your memories of
Brilliant
Bronson?
Yeah.
It's a terrible shame that he's now gone. He really did give some good advice. Mm. Very strict, just like he was in there. You know, he liked things being done properly. But yeah, he gave a lot of good advice, and it was good to work with him, especially as later in life you realise the work he'd done in the past, you know. Mm. The fact that you had a chance to work with him.
And he was hidden. He would have loved to have been here today.
Right? Yeah.
Extremely. Mm. He was so proud of Grange HIll. Over everything he'd done, he was so proud of it.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, there was somebody who was on earlier talking about how much he was an ambassador for the show, how much he loved it, how much he was watching EastEnders ratings to see if they overtook it. Yeah.
We did, at the time, get more ratings than EastEnders. Yeah. Mm. Do you remember he had that toupee, didn't he? Like,
yeah.
Remember, I'd say, I'd like, keep your hair on, sir.
Yeah. But again, lucky, you know, he's another iconic character of the show, isn't he, at the time when you're in it. You know, what do you think it was? Because there's a certain kind of brew, isn't there, when you get a lot of really strong characters and a lot of strong stories at the time that makes it special, I guess. Mm. What do you think? Because you had Anthony Minghella writing scripts, didn't you? I mean, why do you think that it was a magic? Why do you think it's called the Golden Age of Grange HIll?
I think just because it really did appeal to a lot of school kids at the time, you know. Like everyone said, we used to rush home before we got in the programme to watch it. It was very gritty as well for a children's TV programme. Me personally, like everybody else, was very proud to be in it. The fact that it ran for so many years and there was so many great characters in it. Mm. So yeah, it is iconic, yeah. Mm. And I'm very proud to have been part of it. Yeah.
I think the show had been running for sort of like 6 to 8 years when they've come up with some great storylines. And the kind of storylines they did just got better and better and better and better, and then suddenly it had to reach a sort of peak. And I think 1986, 87, 88, 89 were Grange HIll golden years, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think I stopped watching it about 1990.
Right.
I want to watch it again now. Yeah. Now I've seen those clips.
Yeah. YouTube.
Yeah.
Well, I think the first four series are up on DVD, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got them at home.
the next lot. Probably won't get released.
Yeah. Does anybody have any questions for our famous four? Go on.
This is for Lee. Just a dumb question. First, I thought the chemistry between you and Lee Spark was really good. Did you know each other before? Did you just like click in?
No, it's such a shame that Lee went, because the chemistry was. Because at the time, I remember going for the part and they were looking for a tough character and like a bit of a wise guy, and obviously Lee was a wise guy. I turned up, I had bobber boots, skinhead, I used to do boxing, so I was like fitted the part straight away. And I think the chemistry between the early stuff, which I started watching my little boy, and he's brilliant between the two of us. Mm. And it's such a shame, for whatever reason, Lee went, and I think he went way before he was due to go, to be honest. I just think that partnership would have been, you know, it would have been iconic between them two, up until the fifth year, but I think he left on the third year or quite early on.
Yeah, because I know there's some like legend that he was scripted to basically die, but his parents pulled him out of the show. I don't know if you know anything about
that. Yeah, I mean, he was supposed to do the Jeremy Dine scene that he didn't want to do, which was fair enough, but the reason he went, I'm not 100% sure, but he was scheduled for the whole show to the end, but he didn't, and it's a shame he wasn't there, because The two of us were terrible twins. It was really good fun on and off screen.
You used to beat me up.
We did. But Lee made me do it. It wasn't me.
Are you still in touch with him at all?
Only through Facebook. It's like, I think a lot of us have been in more contact since probably the last 4 or 5 years. Through. I mean, me and Erkin do quite a bit anyway. We've done some stuff for Channel 4, and we do a lot of PAs together, because we sort of, you know, work well together. People remember Roland Zammo, so we do loads of stuff together.
Unfortunately, sorry to disrupt. Unfortunately, because of I'm shit at technology, really. I saw Lee 2 weeks ago, Lee Sparks. He was over from Australia, and he sent me all a message, but I only gave it to Scott. Oh, here we go. I'm not going to shut up now.
Is it a message?
Yeah.
I can't read it. Jonah, he's having some beers on your behalf. So, good night, yeah. So, I'm going to go for 64. Ching. There's lots of jokes in 30 years.
Yeah. So yeah, that's actually. I was with him 2 weeks ago. He lives in Australia now, so yeah, he comes over and he said like he really wanted to be here because of the schedules and stuff. Sorry, I don't know if that was meant to be a surprise, but and I said to him, you know, if you could go back to the time we all did together, what would be greatest moment? He said just hanging out with you lot, which I thought was quite nice. So.
Sorry, just yeah, that's my best ever episode. Yeah. Is the two episodes that I showed my little son. I keep saying my son, he loves them. Is the Cheshire and Zoo one with the sea lions, and also which I think is brilliant is Roland not coming out the toilet and us getting him out with sea bombs. That is so. Their episodes to me are the first ones we did, and I just. And I stay with me forever. It was so lovely.
It's funny you should say you watch it with your kid. I brought my two here, and we've been, you know, I've reduced my childhood yet a second time, you know, through them and showing them all the stuff.
And you watch them, and sometimes I've done stuff and I've watched it again and thought, oh, that weren't that good. But the early Grange HIll stuff I watch, and I still sit there with a big smile on my face. I think they was done really well, and they're just really good fun to watch.
It's funny, everyone had gone to and got bushcrafts from that. So can your kids still relate to it? I go, they love it. Yeah. Absolutely love it.
I understand that. I got a message from a 10-year-old the other day from on Facebook saying, I just watched, he just loves Grange HIll. He just said, you know, my mum and dad said to watch
who
this.
Who was that?
Something Regan.
Yeah, I did. Message. And he was like,
I was thinking he's 10 years of
age.
It was
written really badly, and I was like, I said, oh, you said I'm 10, but my parents have got me to watch Grange HIll.
And that's really good that a 10-year-old can still sort of relate to the issues and storylines.
Especially as times change as well, don't they? But it's still.
In lots of ways, it's a much more innocent time there, isn't it? Until the drug story.
We're the only kids in Britain that don't say.
Yeah, that was. Yeah.
Didn't swear in school.
We've only got time for one last question, Scott.
Any memories of working with Gwyneth Powell?
Oh, yeah, Mrs. McCluskey. Yeah, she was lovely, wasn't she? She was really lovely. There was this kind of sort of when you watch the show and you'd see Gwyneth, she's the headmistress, but she was kind of a really lovely, warm, wasn't she?
Yeah.
Caring woman, and there was no kind of boundaries. She'd treat you like a fellow actor rather than treat you like a kid.
Yeah.
And that was really, really lovely. She was, she was really lovely.
She used to travel all the way from Brighton, was it, every day?
Mm. I mean, I was lucky enough to meet Gwyneth a couple of years ago, and it's just something that me and Terry did. And she was just like, hello, how are you? It's like, she was just so warm, so lovely. Yeah. And she, you know, she's got such fond memories of the show. And that's really good after so much work that she's done over the years.
And I did a show with Matt Lucas only 18 months ago with Bullet Baxter and Mrs. McCluskey. And I was like, I couldn't wait to get my picture done to my photo. I was like, yeah, this is really cool. And I had school uniform on as well. So they've still got that impact. Now I was like, I couldn't wait. As soon as it was still, I was on Facebook. I was like, that's Mr. Baxter. Yeah. And they are such lovely people. For me, it weren't until, because when you're doing Grange HIll and you got the adult, they were still adults and teachers. We were segregated from them in the fact all the kids were in one room, the adults were one. So it wasn't for me until I left Grange HIll and I worked or met them at awards or worked with them on other stuff that I realised what lovely, lovely people they...
Yeah.
When Gwyneth is, she's a brilliant actress as well. Same as Brian. Brian's here today. And it's like when you get older, you realise you're all adults and you're not kids. And it is lovely meeting up with them again as well.
So to finish off, how would you sum up your time in Grange HIll? What does it mean to you, that sort of you link?
The best years, as I say, I remember running over to watch Grange HIll, and then when I auditioned for Grange HIll, it was like unbelievable, because I think we was captive by three channels, BBC One, nobody watched BBC Two at that time, there's no kids programmes, and then ITV, so you had to watch, and all of a sudden Grange HIll come on, you had like Bagpuss and stuff like that, all of a sudden Grange HIll come on, and you could relate to each one from your school, you go, oh God, I know that character, we've got someone like that at school. So it was a real programme. And to be in it was unbelievable for the whole of my time through it. And even now, it's like, probably more so now that, you know, because of Facebook and social networks, that I realise the impact it had on other people. And for me, it was just, like, unbelievable.
Tim, how do you sum up your time?
Yeah, very much like Lee said, I'm very proud to have been in the programme, as I say, because it is iconic. I was very lucky to get the part I got as well. I originally auditioned for the part of Loop, which he was only in the programme for a year, so I was very lucky to get the part of Banksie. I'd done 6 weeks auditions for Loop and done 3 week auditions for Banksie and got given the part of Banksie, so I was very, very pleased to have got that part, and as I say, I'm very, very chuffed that I was in it. Right. Very pleased that I was in it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was a bit of a cliche, but it was like the best years of your life. It really was.
Yeah.
Just because of the fun. I mean, if you could have sort of filmed us outside as well. And we weren't bad children. We were really mischievous. And I remember being backstage, and there'd be like new, like you'd have a runner on the, you know, you'd be backstage, and they'd just be about to film, and there was these two runners, and they just must have been just out of art school, and they was about 18 years old, and we're like, you know, about 14, 15, and they've got this headset on, and they're getting, the producers, the directors are in the, you know, up in the gods, in the studios, and they're telling them to cue us, and they're going to us, cue, and we're going, she's going, cue, do you remember? That was only young, cue, cue, and we're like, no. And then we'd walk out and they'd be like, oh no, and they'd be like, why didn't you cue them earlier? I did. So, but you know, it was good fun. It was really, really was the best years of my life. My proper real school life was horrible, it wasn't very nice. But that was kind of, it was a relief, you know, it was fun. And I think that shows, you know, with watching the clips again.
Right. Yeah. Can.
Well, just what everyone else has said, you know, I think anybody that's been associated with Grange HIll has been proud to be a part of it. And I feel that anybody that's, after all these years, still get recognised for a show like that, and any actor that's been in the show, you know, should thank their lucky stars they got the opportunity, because you know what? Millions of kids in Great Britain wanted to be on that show. We were the lucky ones. Mm-hmm. We're the chosen ones. Mm-hmm. So I'll always be proud of that.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, please thank the class of 85 for coming today.